the early 1960s, spy stories on TV and in the movies became very popular. While some shows focused on espionage and intrigue, others expanded into a type of spy-fi, a mixture of genres. They combined the suspense and adventure of espionage with the wow factor of high-tech gadgetry. The James Bond movie series shows the pattern. In 1962, the first Bond film, Dr. No, played the spy kit very low-key. It was the villain, Dr. No, who had the fantastic technology. Then, in 1963, the next movie, From Russia with Love, showed 007 outfitted with a high-tech attache case. It contained bullets, money, and a smoke bomb if you opened it wrong. The movie also showed an early spy tape recorder that was built into a movie camera. Television programs took a similar approach. The popular Avengers series started as an espionage and intrigue show in 1961, but they soon incorporated high-tech in their plots to increase the audience appeal. Later spy programs, such as The Man from U.N.C.L.E. and Mission Impossible, featured high-tech gadgets, which became part of the show's appeal. What has this got to do with tape recorders? That's a secret hiding in plain sight. In 1962, in the American consumer market, portable tape recorders were the highest tech available. Besides being new and exciting, these devices were following a trend. They were getting smaller and smaller thanks to the transistor. Spy shows quickly picked up on this, and little radios and tape recorders either appeared as, or were inferred to be, integral to many secret agent missions. This tiny tape recorder was featured in The Avengers, Season 4, Episode 22, What the Butler Saw. The Avengers recorder was a prop, but in 1966, real consumer portable tape recorders did appear in the prologue to episodes of the TV show Mission Impossible. In this prologue, we see a Concorde F-20 sound camera. This machine is easily recognized at the time and was a good seller, perhaps because of the TV exposure. In a later prologue, we see another popular tape recorder, this time made by Sanyo. It was also a very popular machine and it was a good seller. It is possible that the TV show helped with the sales. Given all this, it is no wonder that many people came to think of portable tape recorders as spy equipment. Realizing the value of their products appearing on TV and the movies, some manufacturers even designed their tape recorders to appear to be easily concealed. Some tape recorders were built inside attaché cases to suggest they might be used for espionage. This Crown cassette recorder from 1967 even had a hidden microphone and a secret button to activate the recorder while the case was closed. The perceived espionage connection was so popular that even low-end and very cheap little tape recorders became enormously popular and sales were brisk. All this brings us to the saga of this little tape recorder, the Snowman reel-to-reel portable recorder. It uses reels that are only 1 7/8 inches in diameter. This design appeared under many brand names, including Starlight, Electra, Toho, and Juliet. Fast forward to 2018. The little recorders of yesteryear are still with us, now as collector's items. Many are listed as spy recorders on eBay. Often the prices are high. Nostalgia, imagination, and design give them appeal and value. These small machines are a collectible piece of history. I was a child in 1963 when the Snowman tape recorders went on sale, and they cost about $20. Today they can be quite expensive. I was amused to watch the high price sales on eBay over the years, never thinking to own one of these machines. I had seen it as a child, I didn't need to have one. Until one day when one of them broke, and the owner offered it for sale at an incredibly small sum. I thought, that would make an interesting video for YouTube, so I bought it. And as expected, it arrived DOA. What had broken, and how did I fix it? In fact, what is this little machine, and how does it work? That is the subject of this video. So come along with me in our journey through the past as we uncover the clues how this machine was designed, built, and how it operates. And yes, after 55 years, this little wonder can still tell its own story.
reel-to-reel tape recorder.
This tape recorder is in workable condition, but it does have a few issues. It's a very tiny machine, and it's called Snowman. As you can see right here, we look at there, it says Snowman. Now, you would also sometimes see this with Starlight, Electrohome, Toho, and other brand names, Juliet, Mayfair. This design was used by a number of Japanese manufacturers, and it dates from approximately 1963. This is a very collectible item on eBay. Very, very difficult to find now. This is 2018. There were quite a few of them on eBay in earlier years, going for quite a bit of money. Collectors like them because they think they're spy recorders. If we look at the inside of it, we can see that it is absolutely the tiniest little thing for this time period. These are 1 3/4 inches reels, both of them, and they are special reels that do not use the fins that most reels use, but they're held in place through a special mechanism. The machine is not capstan drive, it is rim drive. The motor is underneath this plate here. It does have an electrical record and playback head, and it also has an electrical erase head. The pressure pad is located on this plate, but it doesn't move. It's just enough to hold the tape just very gently against the head itself. The tape is ultra thin because they put a lot of it on here. Obviously, you want to get as much mileage out of it as you can get. Now, if you don't know how to work the machine, that's okay. They came up with a solution. You put a sticker in the lid that shows the various operations. And here is an inspector sticker that says, okay. The speaker is built in here, but the grill was duplicated in the lid so that when you close the lid, you can still hear the tape recorder. Now, this tape recorder, I had to do some work on because the battery compartment, one of the tabs for the battery had broken off. It's a plastic compartment, and I was able to epoxy it back on to repower it. But it's a little wonky here with the switching. It needs some more cleaning, and it's very difficult to get to these switches to clean them. So sometimes it does play back, sometimes it doesn't. I did make a test recording, and what I found out is that it has a very unique feature, and we'll look at it when on the side here. And if you look at the side here, you see it says loud off. And when I turn it all the way off, you see there's a little white thing there, and there's a switch. Hear that? So there's a switch there, and then of course you can turn it. Now, there's no meter anywhere on this machine. So how in the world do you know how loud your volume control is? Well, you don't have to worry about that because it doesn't have an automatic volume control, but it does have a preset fixed auto record level control. So as long as the machine is just turned on, it's going to record at what they set at the factory is the optimal level. Why did they do that? Well, this was able to record from a microphone, and it came with this type of a microphone. This is a standard crystal microphone from the time period. They also made a very tiny little tie clip microphone, but it was a crystal microphone. Those things are impossible to find these days. And it has just a simple, you know, a little plug on the end here that goes into the socket here. And this is the only socket for the tape recorder. You see, there it is plugged in. Now, there's no output. This is the battery compartment cover. Nothing whatsoever. So how in the world could you tell what was happening if you didn't hear it through the speaker? That's why there's that switch on there. You could plug into this microphone jack a special telephone adapter. And what it was a suction cup that you stuck on the receiver of your telephone, and you plugged the other end of it into the tape recorder, and it sent out a low-level signal that matched what a microphone would send out into the tape recorder, so you could record a telephone conversation, both sides. But of course, you know, you want to hear what the tape recorder is hearing, so to test it, you would need to turn this to the off position, and at that point, this begins to act as a PA system. Now, if you were using another kind of line input with a, you'd have to have a dropping resistor to drop the signal down to the levels that the tape recorder wanted, that PA system could come in very handy during recording because it acts as a record monitor. As we look at this, we see it's an all-metal case, and it has a clip here that lets you open it up. The tape is held in place by friction, and if you see here, see this little rubber? That's holding it in by friction. So you could turn this like this, and the tape wouldn't fall out. They give you instructions on how to use it, and here's the inspection sticker. On top of this, we see with the metal case, we see that we have hinges, and they're permanently attached, so you cannot take the lid off of the machine. Now, I suppose you're supposed to be able to put this in your pocket. You have to have some pretty deep pockets to carry this around. As I say, most people like to call them spy recorders nowadays. I was alive in 1962 when this came out. This was not a spy recorder. Now, spy TV shows and movies, of course, were extraordinarily popular. James Bond had come out with Dr. No, or whoever made the James Bond movies came out with Dr. No, and then they came out with From Russia with Love is the second one. Very popular, and in the second Bond movie, they had some gadgets being shown off in an attache case, and that was the beginning of the spy gadget craze. And so this tied into the popular imagination, and then later on we would see shows like Mission Impossible, where they had all sorts of tape recorders that they liked to set fire to at the beginning of the show. And you know, this tape will self-destruct in 30 seconds. So that never happened in real life that I know of. And it certainly wouldn't happen with this. Now this machine was, although it's a rim drive machine, doesn't sound that well. This machine was pretty expensive for its day. I saw these in the stores, and they were going for around, if I recall correctly, $25. Now I was in high school at the time, and $25 is a lot of money for a high school kid in 1962 or 63. The problem is that for that kind of money, if you could save up twice as much, you could get a full-size desktop tape recorder like a Webcor, an RCA, a Westinghouse, which would give you a lot more tape recorder value for the money. Because this is fun because it's so portable, it's unique. That's about the most you can say for this. It's unique. It's not very practical at all. It's clumsy to use. These reels are very complicated to put in and out. They used to sell them in replacement packs. You get three tapes in a pack. Threading is not that easy. That's why they show you the threading diagram up here. Can't keep it in the camera range. There it is. So here's the threading diagram that shows you how to thread it. And if you didn't thread it correctly, you didn't make a recording. So this is a little bit, again, as I say, the switch on here is a little bit buggy. I had it working really well, but it needs another cleaning, and I don't want to take this apart to clean it again. It's very, very complicated. It plays back pretty well. You jiggle it, you'll get it to play back, and that's all you really need it for. I need it for. My purpose in having the machine was to make this video. Now that I've made this video, the machine is ready to go into the collection and just be a display piece. And it is a pretty machine. It's very, very nicely made. It's a quality machine. You see there's little spots you see on the case there, and that's where I put some black magic marker to compensate for scratches. Because this is a painted case. It's all metal. Everything in the machine is metal except for the battery compartment, which is plastic. And of course, the components. Now, amazingly, you know, all the capacitors in here are still pretty good. There's no problem with them. We get a lot of volume off it, and it performs pretty well. The other feature that I didn't show you, if I open it up, is it has, besides the built-in speaker, it has a speed control here. So let me rewind it. And the speed control has no effect on rewind. Now, let's see if I can get it to play again. Oh, got to turn on the volume.
Parameter. I am a rim drive tape recorder, and I do not have...
That's the slowest speed.
By reducing by a circuit isn't the best, so my sound quality isn't that great. But I will allow ClydeSight to explain all of that to you as we take an exploration of how I was built and how I work.
You're in for a few surprises, so stay tuned to the video.
And so there you go. If you stay tuned to the video, I'll show you what this looks like on the inside. I'm now going to demonstrate the operation of the tape recorder. So to do that, I'm going to open it up so you can see everything that's happening. Now, look at the side here and we'll see the controls. They're labeled on the lid. We have rewind, PB for playback, RC for record. When you push the RC button, the playback button goes down, and S for stop. The stop button should be engaged all the time because it puts the brake on the feed table so that the tape doesn't spill. Now let's put it down and open it up. Before we do that, over on this side, we have the volume control, which has a switch. So if we want to hear it, we've got to make sure that we've turned it on and turned it up to some degree. We can adjust it as needed. So let's open it up. Remember that this is rewind, this is play, this is record, and this is stop. So we'll push play first.
So cool is that I have one of the smallest portable reel-to-reel tape recorders ever made. My reels are up 1 3/4 inches in diameter. I am a real.
It has a speed control. That's the slowest speed.
Isn't the best, so my sound quality isn't that great. But I will allow ClydeSight to explain all of that to you as we take an exploration of how I was built and how I work.
There's the stop button. Now we'll go rewind. And watch what happens when it reaches the end. See how it stopped? And that's because the tape is attached to the hub. Now if I put it back in play, sorry about the light. And you see, it's got this funky switch. You can see it slow down.
What makes me so cool is,
and you can see it speed up. Now, you will see that there's 4 screws here over this plate. And you would think you take that off and you could get access to the motor and the drive system. No, that's not the way that works. This actually, it does give you access to the motor, but not from here. You have to go in through the back side of the machine to get to the motor, which means you have to take the whole machine apart, which is done by removing these screws, this one here, this one here, and you have to remove the back cover for the batteries. I'll show you how the batteries were installed. This will work with a coin, but a screwdriver is just as easy to use. It also has a retaining clip, so you will not lose the big screw. And I replaced the foam. The foam was, of course, deteriorated. That pops the thing up so you can get it out. So it has 2 AA batteries, AA size batteries. And it also has this 9 volt. So we'll take modern batteries, although modern batteries are a little bit bigger than the batteries from the time period. Now, this is the battery compartment. It's plastic. And the reason why I was able to get this machine from eBay is that the seller couldn't get it to work anymore because this terminal strip for the battery and the plastic that holds it had broken off. And the seller had no idea how to get it back in. So I was able to glue it back in using epoxy, and it now holds together pretty well. We're looking at the tape recorder outside of its case, and I've also removed the reels so that you can see how the little reel tables work. Now, looking at the construction should give you an idea that this is definitely not a capstan drive tape recorder. It is a reel drive or rim drive tape recorder. There are several clues to that. One is there's no capstan. That should be the most obvious clue. You could possibly confuse the tape guides for a capstan, but there's no pinch roller, so this is not a capstan-driven tape recorder. The other giveaway is look at the way the tables are made. There's a center area, which is in this case just gold paper on both of them, and then the rubber completely wraps around the table. So there's rubber here on this side, and there's rubber on the underside, and the same for this table. And that's very characteristic of a rim drive tape recorder. The biggest giveaway for me is this plate here. That conceals the motor. Now, this is what I call a transverse drive tape recorder because the motor has its spindles going like the pointer is here. So for the take-up table, the spindle of the motor is underneath the table and it presses against the table, causing it to rotate in a counterclockwise direction, which is necessary when the feed table is on this side, so it can collect the tape. On this side, the motor has a shaft coming out, but what they've done is put a little brass bushing on the shaft to make it a larger diameter so that when it spins, it turns this table about twice as fast as this table for the rewind. It's not particularly fast rewind, and because of the small size of the tape, that's why they didn't make it too fast. Otherwise, you would way overcompensate when you rewind and it would make it difficult to find what you're looking for. Of course, all things are relative. It depends on how long your tape is. Over here, we see a speed control. Here are the push buttons for the rewind, the play, the record, and the stop. And the stop button, when it's pressed in, prevents this table from turning very easily. But it can be disengaged accidentally by knocking one of the other buttons. So let me hit one of the other buttons here, just slightly, and you see how the thing popped out here. Now, this table can spin. Now, that's not something you want to have happen, because when that happens, the tape, which is very thin, can unravel off the reel. So on this type of machine, it's very important to keep that stop button pressed in. There's no way to prevent it from popping out by accident. This is as much as we can see from the top side, so let's turn it over and see what's going on underneath. Now, it's a completely self-contained machine, so we don't have to worry about the speaker wires or anything like that. And here we see how really, really delicate the thing is. Here is the battery compartment. There's space for a AA battery, space for the AA battery, and here is the clip for the 9-volt battery. This had broken, which is why I was able to get the machine, because the seller didn't want to deal with it. This tab here, which holds the terminal clip for the battery, had literally broken off the plastic, and I simply epoxied it back in. What's also kind of interesting about this is that they split the amplifier. So we have a partial amplifier here and a partial amplifier here. Now, you've got to remember that this is in early 1960. I'm guessing this is about 1963, possibly 62. This is during the beginnings of portable tape recorders coming out of Japan. And miniaturization was a very, very big idea at the time. If you look in catalogs, you can even look on eBay and you'll see them. Look up tiny transistor radio. And you will see that there are very small radios, no bigger than this battery compartment, sometimes even smaller than that, made by Sony, believe it or not, or Standard Radio Japan, Juliet, Mayfair, and other well-known names from the time period that made these little tiny radios. They were mostly AM radios, but I have seen them in AM and FM. And they look like little cubes. And they held all the components for a radio, which are pretty daunting when you think about it, because the radio has a lot of components in it. Here we see some power capacitors. I believe they're power capacitors. Here's some transistors. There's two of them here, little transformers. And the speaker is underneath here, mounted right directly to the case. This is so tiny, you don't want to take it out. Plus, 50-year-old wiring. You don't want to fool with that. And of course, here is the switch volume control. Now, if we look over here, we see what I think is probably the preamp part of the circuit. And it has a number of capacitors in it, plus some transistors. And it also has, it's DC bias, so it doesn't have a bias coil. But it also conceals the switches that are controlled by the push buttons here. So that's all underneath this board. I had to take this board out to clean the switches. I really regretted having to do that because it took a long time to get it aligned back again. Very difficult to work with because it's so tight. But it's so tight because that's the whole point. You want to make it tiny. Here is the motor that we saw the cover for. And you can't remove that cover and pull the motor out. The motor is actually accessible from inside, not outside. So you have to take this out and you have to take the amplifier board out. It gets very complicated. A little tiny machine doesn't mean it's easier just because it's smaller. So here's the motor, and I'm going to hold it a little bit differently for you. And I want to show you how the mechanism works. I'm bringing it up close. I want you to look at this part here. Now I'm going to press the rewind button and watch what changes. See how that spring changes? I'll put it in play. Spring's released. Spring's pulled. And now watch the motor when I do that. Here we go to play. See it angle here? It's angling here. Now it's going to angle here when I push rewind. See that? I'm trying to keep this as steady as possible for you. Okay? So that is part of the mechanics for how that works. And it's very delicate, and it's not something you want to play with much or fuss with. I put this green pad here to help the battery, the 9-volt battery, stay in place. And finally, what I want to show you is right here. This is the microphone input, and this is the only input on the machine. This has an on-off switch, and that turns the power on and off to the amplifier. If you leave the battery in, this will get power when this switch is on. So you have to turn it off, otherwise you'll exhaust the battery. The AA batteries don't have that problem because they're switching for the motor. The motor switching does not control the amplifier switching. Now, why is this here? Because this has not an automatic level control, but it has a preset recording level control. The thing is on the side there. You can't see it when you're playing with it. I'm going to make a recording. I turned this up. I don't know how far up I've turned it. There's no markings on it. Very hard to tell. So the only marking that's there is this one to tell me I've turned it off. So to make this work better for people, especially because they're expecting that people aren't going to want to waste a lot of time trying to figure out meter settings and so on, they put this control in there and set it at the factory to what's probably the mid-level of the amplifier. So it's just a fixed volume control, but it prevents you from overloading by turning this up too far. It's a metal case, and as you can see, the speaker is mounted here, and you can see how they pushed the grill in and folded it over on the inside. Getting this little amplifier board out is very difficult, and what I would recommend, if you get one of these machines, try and get one that's already working, because if you get one that's not and you want to repair it, it's going to be a real, real challenge. If you like the challenge, go for it. But if you don't know anything about working on these machines, or you just beginning, anything like that, this is going to be a real challenge. It's even a challenge for me. So this is the inside of the machine, how they built it. It's very compact. It's a very clever use of miniaturization. It was the very beginning of doing miniaturization. This is what made the Japanese manufacturers so famous in the 1960s, because they could put together a precision machine like this. And this is not the most precision machine that they made at the time. There were other tape recorders that used these little reels, believe it or not, that were about the same size, and they had capstan drive, which meant they had to have in a flywheel, they had to have a clutch mechanism, they had to have special mechanisms for fast forward and rewind. They were full-featured machines, And they probably had AC bias. I've seen them in catalogs. I've never actually seen them in real life. So I can't tell you how well they worked. So that's the inside of this tape recorder. The tape recorder is going to go into this metal case that we saw before in the introduction. Now I want to talk about the tape that goes on here. This is really amazing to what they did. Here are the tape. Here's the reels of tape. Now you can see that they do not have slots in them for the fins that you normally see on a reel. I'll get a 3-inch reel to show you. Here is a 3-inch reel, and you can see the slots for the fins that are on the reel tables. No such slots. Furthermore, the 3-inch reel has holes cut in it. See that? I'm not giving you the finger. There, I'll use my index finger. See, now we can't get offended. And you can see that it has holes cut in it for the tape and a hole here for threading. This has faux holes. I don't know what else to call them. They make it look like there's a hole here, but there's no hole, and there's no way to thread the tape. So how did they work this? Well, what they did was they sold the tapes in pairs like this. I remember seeing them in Lafayette Radio Electronics, believe it or not. They sold them usually in a 3-pack, and the tape is actually secured to both hubs so that when it is fully rewound, the tape keeps it from coming off the reel, and when it's fully played, the same thing happens here. This is a half-track tape recorder, which means you can flip the reels over like that. Very difficult to do because of the way it works with the reel table. The inside of the table is coated with a rubber tube on both of these. That tube grips the neural shaft and keeps the reel from coming off the machine while you're carrying it around. Very difficult to get this off, and the plastic can get brittle, so if you pull the plastic, you can break the reels. That's why they sold you extra reels. The tape itself is extremely thin. It's as thin as cassette tape is, but it's full 1/4-inch tape. So it's an early example of miniaturization. Ironically, when this machine was built, Philips in Holland was just about ready to launch the compact cassette. And a compact cassette meant the end of these machines because it could do all the things that this machine could do better with more convenience for everybody. It just was very expensive at the time because it was brand new. But we all know how that progressed brilliantly through time, and we had all the wonderful legacy of the compact cassette. But this is what came out before that. And at the time this was made, they expected that these would be around for a very long time. Thank you for watching this ClydeSight Productions video about the Snowman portable 1 3/4-inch reel-to-reel rim drive tape recorder from the 1960s. Thanks for watching the video. Stay tuned to ClydeSight channel for more vintage tape recorder explorations. Bye-bye, YouTube.